Helgi, when Balanchine first choreographed the ballet, when you thought he was finished, you didn't have a solo, did you?
No, that's true.
How did this come about? When, how much later did this come about, and how did you learn about it?
It happened quite a bit later. This was for the Stravinsky Festival in 72. And this happened to be one of the very first ballets he worked on and choreographed. And at that time, it did not have a solo. I would have liked to have had a solo, but that's how we saw it, and that was it. I was still very pleased that I was in it, and it was a beautiful pas de deux. How much longer? I want to say several weeks. Many weeks. He had choreographed other ballets in the meantime, and I really had no idea that it would ever do anything, be anything else. We were working on Symphony in Three Movements, and one day, up in the hallway, I met Gordon Walzner, the pianist. And I had just seen on the schedule something. I was called for rehearsal with him and Mr. B. The next day, and I said, "Do you know anything about this?" And not thinking that this had anything to do with Beze. And he said, "Well, he sort of looked at me and smiled. He said, "I think Mr. B maybe wants to do something for you." Great. So he came in. I came in the next day for the rehearsal, and it was late in the afternoon. And Mr. B said to me, I found this music."
And the music was from another part of the ballet.
Yes.
In other words, from the original Baiser de la Fée.
And he said, "This music is wonderful. I don't remember anything that I did at that time, but it had to do with the fortune teller. And let's see, maybe I can maybe do a little solo for you." And that's how it started.
Be careful what you wish for.
Right. And he sort of asked Gordon to play a little bit, and he listened to the music, and he got out in the middle of the studio, and I tried to follow him, and he sort of said da 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 da, and I kept looking, and I tried to imitate what I had seen, and then he stopped, and he said, "Show me," and I showed him. And, okay, let's go on, and that was it. I mean, he was on a roll. Normally, I remember he did not change very much. Once he set a step on you or choreographed something, it was very seldom he changed it. And I don't remember anything about him saying, "Oh, I don't like that, let's change that," or "No, let me start again."
He just went right through?
Kept going and kept going. And it was really hard to keep up with him because it was an unusual variation. In the sense, it was not certainly not a classroom steps.
Yes.
Changing of directions and music was not easy to hear because he sort of just listened to the music. And remembering, he would stop and think a bit and sort of said, "Okay." And then we start again. And all of a sudden, there we were. About an hour and 20 minutes later, and he said, "Take a break, you know, go over it, think about it." I took about 10 minutes, and he said, "Well, show me." And I did, trying to remember every step and every nuance and arms and bending and everything else, and he just sort of looked at it and said, "Good."
And then you said before, you were telling Gonzalo how he then went away and didn't see it again until,
I guess,
the dress rehearsal.
Yeah.
But so you worked on this by yourself during
that
time.
Yeah, he did say that. He said, "You work on it and show me what you will do with it, what you will do with it."
What were there things, I know that Patty McBride had once spoken about the fact that there were things that she did where he didn't give her arm placements, for instance. Were there things that he sort of left to you to figure out, or is everything we saw, was it all there?
When he demonstrated, you might not say that the arm movements, or for that matter, leg movements, were always done exactly what you did. You learn to read his nuances, what he was looking for. And sometimes you might not have understood it, and he said, "No, do it more this way or that way. But I think our movement, I'm pretty sure that this is basically what he showed me. I mean, it might have not been absolutely, you know, mm-hmm. but sort of bring the arm up and sort of the feeling, you could sense that he felt all this in the music.
Yeah.
So you just, you know, you would just make sure that you would catch everything. I think that's what it was.
Did you told Gonzalo before too not to count, but did you ever find while you were sort of teaching it to yourself and just trying to remember it, did you ever find
no,
a need to
because
count?
No, because he had not taught it to me like that.
Mm-hmm.
He had taught me to listen to the music and go with the music.
The rhythm especially, you kept emphasizing the rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
Was that something, again, as you listened to it more, that's when you began to hear it, or did you hear that from the start?
Honestly, I don't think it was that much in the beginning because it sort of just came
everything.
Like a flood
uh-huh.
at you, you know,
uh-huh.
all these steps and this incredible choreography, and just to take it all in. But I realized very quickly that, yes, you know, there's that rhythm, there's pulse,
mm-hmm.
and yet he wanted you to move and change directions and make it big and articulate.
It's obviously extremely difficult.
Yes.
You can count the ways, I think,
yes,
that it's difficult.
It is.
What's the most challenging part of it?
In a way, it is the stamina.
Mm-hmm.
Because I always felt it progressively gets harder. The steps became more difficult to execute, and you needed incredible control to do some of those steps, as you've probably seen.
Mm-hmm.
It starts out very simple. Bon, tendu, step, plissade, écarté, position. And then all of a sudden you start to jumping and you start to do this and you start changing directions and
mm-hmm.
on a very short notice. So it was like you need to always keep it very much together, and yet you had to make it look like you were free at it. And by the time you come to the last manège with the assemblées,
yes.
you just you say, it can't be, you know, isn't this over yet? It must
uh-huh.
be, and it's still another phrase, you know. I think that was. Because once I got it in my body, all the changing directions, it was fun to do.
Really?
Yeah. It was.
Even.
It was always a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I would find things in it. Every time I danced it, but I think the most difficult part was just stamina-wise to make it look easy all the way through the end.
Well, the manège also, the movement with the head
mm-hmm.
was something that obviously Gonzalo was struggling with a little bit. And again, is this something that was there at the very beginning? Because it's so unusual. It's almost like you're going in two different directions in a sense.
It is, and I think it's a combination of maybe what I did as a mistake
uh-huh.
and whatever. As you remember looking at it, it is very little time you have to one, two, up, down. And I think it started out as a tourcité en tournant. And it was like not enough time,
mm-hmm.
so I think I started to try to get mm-hmm. get to the next beat.
Uh-huh.
And maybe it was that he sort of said to me, yes, that, you know, that's good. But keep the head position like, and
mm-hmm.
then he said, okay, look, as you get into the jump, look where you came from, and then go back to where you're going. So we just
uh-huh.
sort of, how can I say, articulated more. But I have the feeling that in me trying to execute the step, maybe a conventional step,
uh-huh.
and not have enough music time to do it in that space of music,
mm-hmm.
I tried to anticipate the next thing and maybe start looking ahead.
Literally.
And I think
uh-huh.
that's what really happened with it. Because he did not say, okay, I want you to jump and look back and front and that, you know. No, it was not like
right.
that.
And did he set that tempo at the beginning, or was that
yes.
something that you were, so it wasn't like
yes.
you found that was your comfort zone or
no,
something, it was
no.
just there from the beginning.
Yeah.
He wasn't known for telling people what a dance was about.
No.
You said before that he mentioned that this was, that he remembered something about it was from a gypsy music or something.
Yeah, the fortune teller. Yeah.
Did he say anything else? Did he give you any clues while you were working on it?
No, other than, you know, it was mysterious. The music is mysterious. Mm-hmm. And I remember him something about saying, you know, as a fortune teller with a crystal ball looking, you know. It was that kind of, so when you did all that, I don't think it meant anything in particular other than it was just a feeling of the music and the sort of mystery, what is that? And he created things and sort of out of nowhere.
Well, several people called it a gift to you, that solo. Mm-hmm. But I think also he was really known for challenging his dancers, more so the women. And this, I mean, it's obviously a very unusual solo. Had you ever danced anything remotely like this before? How did he challenge you?
I definitely think it's a gift.
Mm-hmm.
I think he did do that to some of his dancers, many of his dancers, the way he choreographed for them. But he had this incredible ability to look at a dancer and being able to sort of sense their quality right away and use that in a choreographic sense.
Mm-hmm.
I had never done anything like that before.
Had you ever seen anything like that before?
No. And so obviously he was challenging me, but he felt that, you know, this was something that I could do, and this is a certain quality that I had. Maybe I didn't know I had.
I was going to ask you that. Were you familiar at all with the story, the Baiser de la Fée story?
Not very much, because, you know, again,
it didn't matter.
I wouldn't say interesting to him, but I mean, that was not important to talk
mm-hmm.
about that.
Mm-hmm.
It was the music, the choreography, the mood, the sense of maybe mystery that he wanted to create, but there was not, he didn't tell me a story.
Right.
No.
But even though this ballet is plotless, you feel like you're watching some kind of a story, and especially with the ending, and he added the ending 2 years after he originally choreographed this.
Yes.
I've never seen it without this ending, so to me it's the most natural thing in the world. I can't mm. imagine it without it. But there's a parting of the way of the two lead characters in this. Did that in any way give you more of a sense of a story, or somehow complete the ballet for you, or make you even feel the solo a little differently?
I think it did. I think it, first of all, the adagio, the first one, is quite unusual. And then when we come into the last adagio, which the one he added,
mm-hmm.
which is extremely romantic.
Yeah.
I mean, it's sort of a combination of Romeo and Juliet and Giselle, or whatever you want to say, and maybe it isn't, but I'm saying mm-hmm. it's on that kind of a level. There is a certain being plotless and without a story.
Right.
There's a definite, an incredible romance taking place.
And there's also a sense of loss.
A loss and a mystery
mm-hmm.
and searching and looking for one another. So I think it tied in with my solo, which had this mystery and you know, where does it go? What am I searching for? What am I grasping for? All the way through.
And we just saw, obviously, the one solo, but you had other things to do in this ballet, which I can't even imagine what it must have been like to come back out after doing this.
Well, this solo followed the first adagio
mm-hmm.
immediately. So that was like, you know, huffing and puffing before
yes.
you started it. Then there's a very nice coda. Good, great coda steps, unusual coda steps again. And then after that, that was used to be the ending of the ballet, and then he added that other whole
mm-hmm.
adagio, an ending.
How difficult is the rest of the ballet?
It's difficult, nothing like this.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's partly difficult because you have done so much before, and
right.
this solo being part of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the second adagio is so beautiful and romantic, and yet a sense of loss. You know, when the last thing you see is we separate, and we walk backwards off stage, bending, mm-hmm. reaching for each other, and by the time we get into the just before the wing, I'm really looking straight up into the lights, bending backwards. That's far, and walking backwards, and so is Patty McBride, who was my partner.
Right.
So you see these dancers just sort of being pulled away. It's like they, you know, it's mm-hmm. it's a story. It's a you can
it
make
is,
anything
yes,
you want of it, but
definitely.
It's, the romance is there. It's a loss. It's a
mm-hmm. and the core is very involved in that. In
very
that
much,
also,
yes. And it's complicated steps for them and music.
Is that, what makes it complicated?
Again, I think the music is complicated.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an easy music to listen to, and it's very rhythmical, but it's a lot of counterpoint with the core.
Mm-hmm.
But he did some wonderful things for the core. He really used them in a beautiful way, and they danced a lot.
This ballet, like as you said, was done for the Stravinsky Festival, so there was a lot going on. You didn't have original costumes made for this.
No.
You, what costumes were you using?
the jacket he put on me,
yeah.
was from Donizetti Variations. And in yeah. Donizetti Variations, I have a white shirt. This is a tunic jacket with sort of pink inlaid in here. Two-tone tights down to the knee, one color, and then white.
Mm-hmm.
So for this, he decided just to have all white tights. And we just, you know, borrowed what we have, what we could use. I mean, we couldn't make costumes for everything. I'm trying to think, how many ballets did we do? 23 ballets?
Something.
Yeah, in the Stravinsky Festival, all premieres. So he would just find costumes from other ballets, and this was one that he said would look good on me, and then it would be right for this. And
that remained the costume. It, he never
right.
changed the
he
costume
never,
later
no,
on.
No.
What was the atmosphere like then? It's the Stravinsky Festival, as you said, and he's choreographing from one thing to the other to the other. Was it chaotic? Was it controlled chaos? And what? I can't imagine
it
anybody doing that.
Incredible
now.
Excitement.
Mm-hmm.
I think from everybody. Everybody sensed this was really something special taking place. And you know, we were all involved with other things, and you know, how we could get everything on stage in time,
mm-hmm.
and tech rehearsals, and somehow it all came together.
Well, some of the other ballets, you had Symphony in Three Movements, then mm-hmm. Duo Concertante, Violin Concerto. Did this ballet get a little lost?
Maybe a little bit, but I think, you know, maybe I shouldn't say this, but I think it didn't get that lost, and I think it's mainly because of this variation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think this variation was so unusual for a male dancer I think for our public and maybe people who wrote about it, that this was something really very different and special that he had done. And I think because of that, you know, we did so many things, and
yeah.
some maybe lasted and some are still going incredibly well. But I think people talked about this variation all the time.
And it wasn't just the steps, I think. I mean, I think it was also the poetry of
it's
this,
very
which
poetic.
Was unusual
yes, yes.
For a male dancer
yeah.
then.
I mean, I think the same thing, what I said before, the adagios are beautiful,
mm-hmm.
what he did for Patty and I.
Mm-hmm.
Patty's solo is wonderful. But I think, honestly, I think there's something special about this solo. And maybe because traditionally male solos tend to be more simplified.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's, you know,
and more bravura, I think.
Bravura, man can jump and turn and under the seas and, you know,
mm-hmm.
that kind of steps. But these were totally different from that.
Have you seen the ballet since you danced it?
Yeah, I saw it a few years ago.
Have you ever taught it?
No.
Did it look different to you when you saw it? Had anything changed about
it? Well,
I
never saw myself in it, so I
don't know. Right, I know, but just the feeling that you had from it, did it, even, if, you know, was the tempo the same, or did anything look different than what you thought it was, or the way you remembered it?
I think it was pretty much the same. Yeah. It's been quite a few years.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was Peter Bowl that was dancing it at that time, and mm-hmm. I remember being in New York, and they knew I was coming, or somebody heard that I was coming tomorrow, and they said, oh, gee, can you possibly come and take a look at this?
Uh-huh.
And I don't think I had the time. I was in New York for maybe a couple of days, one of those trips that I had mm-hmm. to take on behalf of the company. But this has been, this is quite a few years, but I don't think it was that different, no.
Did this solo or this ballet change you at all as a dancer?
That's a good question. I think so, yes, definitely.
How?
Well, first of all, I think part of just being in the Stravinsky Festival, I had been in the company, I joined the company in the spring of 70, this is 72, and it was such a music musical education mm-hmm. to be dancing a lot of Stravinsky ballets, for instance, for this,
and, yeah.
and being choreographed on and not counting things. You know, you had mm-hmm. to learn to listen to the music and mm-hmm. the sounds and whatever. So just that alone sort of was a great musical education and changed how I looked at dance. But I also think that it changed me in the sense that what was possible for a male dancer. It was mm-hmm. not just the pirouettes and double tours. And it was that just being in that company. And I think I had danced with a couple of other companies before I came
right.
to New York City Ballet. And had been a principal dancer there, but truly, I think Mr. B taught me how to move